What it is, what it do, cyber world. It is your girl, the one and only Ash Said It. AshSaidIt.com. AshSaidIt.com, baby babies. Happy hump day. Yeah, it's a hump day. 250,000 streams worldwide. I thank each and every one of you for downloading the Ash Said It Daily Podcast Show. Today, I got a treat, y'all. I got Chef Richard Ingraham.
What's happening? How you doing?
I'm chilling here, Chef. Where are you from? Where do you represent?
Miami, Florida, 305.
When did you realize that you had this calling for the kitchen?
I really realized it at about 27, but I'd been in the kitchen since 10, cooking with my grandmother and my mom and uncles, and I actually was cooking. That was my way to kind of get in to the dating scene when I was a little younger. I would call my friends over, girls, and would have them come over, and we would bake cookies together and stuff like that. So I've been kind of using cooking, though, in the right ways in my life all along. So I would say, you know, from 10 years old on, I kind of knew that, you know, this would be where I want to be eventually, to be behind the kitchen, in the kitchen doing my thing.
So let's rewind, Chef. Okay, you said something interesting. Now, you said that you had your friends, girls, come over. Y'all was baking cookies.
Yeah, you know, she came over and we just, you know, I wanted to bake some cookies. She said she liked to bake cookies. And I said, okay, well, what kind? And I had just seen the movie Ghost. So I don't know if you remember that movie or not, with Patrick Swayze and Jimmy Moore when they were doing the clay thing, you know. So I was like, okay, instead of using clay, I'm going to use cookie dough, you know. And, you know, I said, well, you know, what do you like in your cookies? And, you know, she told me. I went out and got it, and we made some cookies, you know. And, you know, the rest is history.
Smooth operator. Okay, Chef Richard. All right. I see. I take it. Smooth. That's smooth. You know, y'all better be taking notes. Y'all taking notes worldwide. How did you cultivate your craft?
I actually went to the Art Institute of Atlanta. Yeah, I remember going to the school for an interview and looking into the kitchen and seeing all of the students preparing food and the professors teaching and things like that. And smelling all of the food and just seeing the hustle and bustle. And that was around 27, 28. And that's when I really said, you know, this is what I want to do. Went on ahead and I applied and signed my life away for that financial aid, which I'm still paying. And I've been going ever since.
You've also dabbled a little bit into the reality television cooking show field. What are some of the pros and cons of such an industry?
Well, you know, the show that I was on, it was cool. I'm not one for competitions. First of all, my business manager, you know, she said, I think that this is a great opportunity to get yourself out there and be seen. And that's really how I took it. Of course, you go in to win, right. But my main thing was just to really represent and let people see me, see my personality, and hopefully that little 15 minutes of fame would, you know, turn into maybe an hour's worth of fame, you know, after the show was over. But what I've experienced is with these shows, a lot of them, you know, it is what it is. You know, you're going in and you're there for entertainment purposes. And, you know, your cooking skill is just, you know, a cherry on top. It's really about, in some of these shows, just putting on a show. And, you know, I did my part. You know, I didn't get off first, which was awesome. That was a major thing to me.
Yeah.
But I didn't win. And to be honest with you, when I didn't win, I kind of felt a certain way about myself. And I was actually going to stop cooking. And, you know, it took me a while to get my groove back. But when I did, I came, you know, a little bit harder than I did before. And, you know, I could really attribute that show or losing on that show to really giving me the husband that I needed to, you know, elevate my career and to really get into it, you know, good enough so that I could, you know, take myself to another level.
What would you look at as one of your biggest obstacles from start to today?
Well, one of the biggest obstacles that I've had is with myself. Actually, continuing to believe, you know, that I'm doing the right thing, continuing to believe in myself. Why? Because this isn't something that you do and success comes automatically. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been doing this now for, you know, upwards of 17, 18 years. And, you know, there are many a change, but you're not getting paid what you think you should be getting paid, you know, from the restaurant, from working in the restaurant. And then when you step out on faith, like I did to, you know, do what I'm doing now as far as being a personal chef, you know, you really have to dig deep within yourself. And, you know, at some point, you know, I kind of lacked that. So I had to really, you know, as I say, dig deep and really, you know, get that confidence in myself and knowing that, you know, it's going to be okay. You know, you have to get out there at some point and if you really want to do better or be better.
So you are now the current personal chef for NBA star Dwayne Wade and Hollywood's Gabrielle Union. How was that connection made?
Well, actually, Dwayne's manager, Lisa, was one of my clients back in the day because I was a professional hairstylist for about 7 years before I started cooking.
Wow.
So I used to do her hair, actually. And, you know, after I stopped doing hair, like I said, I went to Atlanta and I wound up coming back to Miami and Lisa gave me a phone call and asked me if I wanted to cook for an NBA player. I asked her who. She said, Dwayne. And I said, well, I don't even know who that is. He's just coming to the league. So she said, I tell you what, Google him and then you call me back and let me know if this is something that you want to do. So, of course, I Googled him, and 30 seconds later, I was on the phone like, yes, let me know what I need to do, you know. So, you know, she guided me through the interview process, and I wound up getting a job. And then, of course, Mrs. Union Wade came on the scene, and, you know, she took me to another level mm-hmm. as far as cooking. You know, her palate is quite extensive. She's done a lot of traveling, and she likes to try different things. So, you know, she allowed me to really, you know, spread my wings, so to speak, and to be able to prepare a lot of different things for her, you know. So it's been great. It's been a great ride.
Now, as you were saying, Gabrielle, she has a very extensive palate. One of her favorite meals?
Well, she loves Mexican, so anything Mexican. But right now, one of the things that I make for her that she really enjoys is when I do crab cakes. I do this crab cakes that has quinoa in it and a butternut squash puree. And then I do some sauteed asparagus. So that's one of the meals that I make for her that she, you know, she thoroughly enjoys.
As a personal chef, what is meal prep like for you for the week?
Well, what I do is I try to keep, you know, different protein in the house at all times because you never know, you know, when someone may pop in during dinner time and you may need to whip something up real quick. But I actually shop every day. I shop every day because I don't really plan. You know, I go into the grocery store because I love it. I go in the grocery store and almost like black out to kind of figure out what it is that I want to make for that particular day. So I would go in the morning and, you know, I already have things that I need. And, you know, after I fix breakfast, I go to the grocery store, get things that I need for lunch, get things that I need for dinner. And then I go from there.
And they also have children, correct?
Yes.
I mean, it's one thing, professional chef, you're cooking for adults that they have this palate and they have certain things that they like and, you know, they'll pretty much go whatever. Kids is kind of like another realm, chef, because I got some nieces and nephews and sometimes it's a trying time.
For me, it's a thing where, you know, sometimes I'm doing a couple of different meals for each sitting. So, you know, for Dwayne, it may be one thing. For, you know, for Gabrielle, it's something else. And then for the kids, it's totally different. You know, and that's normally how it is at dinner time. But the one thing that I make sure that they're eating vegetables, you know, there's a vegetable with every meal. And even if they don't eat all of them, you know, I stay on them to make sure that they at least partake in the vegetables. You know, because if you don't stay on them, they'll eat macaroni and cheese, fried chicken, all of that kind of stuff every day, all day.
Good. That's a good, yeah. Like I said, Chef, I'm taking some notes, but I think I might need to pick up this book that you got, Eating Well to Win. Eating Well to Win.
Yes.
Where did the inspiration for this book come from?
The inspiration really came from so many different places. It came from my upbringing, some of my Bahamian background. You start dealing with things like conch and stewed, okra and things like that. But then a lot of the recipes in there are foods that I have prepared for Dwayne, Gabrielle, and for my other clients as well throughout the years. And, you know, it was something that, you know, it's like we were just talking about social media. You know, everyone on social media always asks, you know, where can I get your food? Do you have a restaurant? Things of that nature. So this is my way, basically, to try to reach as many people as possible, you know, with my food and let them enjoy it, you know, just as much as I enjoy making it.
Now, what are some of these recipes looking like, Chef?
Yeah, the recipes, I wanted to make sure that they were not intimidating at all to anyone. Anybody can get in there with the Eating Well to Win cookbook, from a, you know, a chef that's been doing it for a couple of decades to your everyday cook. Because, you know, nowadays everyone is working so hard to make ends meet. You really don't have a lot of time to sit down and try to piece together or to decipher a recipe. So I wrote it so that anybody can get in there and create. The ingredients are the kind that you can go to your local grocery store or farmer's market and pick these things up and create these wonderful dishes for your family or for your friends.
Okay, cool, cool. Last but certainly not least, Chef, what advice would you offer for any up-and-coming chefs?
Well, for any up-and-coming chefs, and this is something that I've discussed with, you know, some of my chef friends who have restaurants and also personal chefs, where, you know, you have students that are coming out of culinary school or, you know, coming from internships and things like that, and they think that, you know, they're the second coming, and they don't even really know how to wash dishes. So my thing is, you need to know every part of the kitchen. You need to know every technique. You need to know every ingredient that you could possibly know. And just keep your head down and work. You know, don't look for accolades, because they'll never come when you're looking for them. You know, if you keep your head down and you just continue to work and continue to learn, then everything that you want will be right there when you finally pick your head up to take a breath. You know, but you have to continue to work hard and persevere and not get drawn into the whole celebrity chef situation and, you know, just wanting to be so much so quickly. You know, just take your time, pace yourself, and work diligently, and your dreams will come true. You know, I'm a living proof of that.
Chef Richard Ingraham, Chef, thank you so very much for sharing with us a little bit of your story, some inspiration for the people.
Yes.
We certainly appreciate you. Chef, what is the best way for people to get into contact with you or if they need to follow you?
You know, if people want to follow, they can go to ChefRLI on Instagram, and it's the same for Twitter, ChefRLI. And our website is www.chefrli.com.
All right. Thank you so much, Chef. Much more success to you. We'll definitely be following you on social platforms, social media. Got to pick up that book,
yes.
Y'all. Definitely picking that
up. And if you need some tips, just hit me up. And then we can walk through them together.
All right. Sound like a plan. Sound like a plan.
Okay.
All right. And I appreciate each and every one of you guys. Thank you for supporting the movement, AshSaidIt.com. Anyone to tell you that you can't do what you want to do, you look them square in the face and tell them, don't believe me. Just watch. Watch what I do. Watch me make it happen. Watch me make history. Because that's what we're doing this for. We're doing this for the history books. Social media is nice. It's cool. It's fun. But real life is so much better. Talk to y'all later.